Let the church say amen again.
Amen.
Or the Holy Spirit say amen one more time.
Amen.
Ms. Sharon, I was blessed by that song.
Yes.
If any of you have ever gone through anything, you know that song is a mere testimony. That I almost let go. Get diagnosed with some type of sickness. Instead of believing that God will heal you, the enemy tells you you're not going to make it. Have a loved one die and go. And you're locked in your house by yourself, no one to talk to. And you really should have lost your mind. You could have lost your mind. But God kept you close. So you would let go. I'm a testimony to that fact that God will deliver you. And he'll be your company keeper when you have no company. And he'll be your healer when the doctor said they've done all they can do. And he'll be your counselor when nobody else can understand what you're going through. He held me close. So I wouldn't let go. I wish I had a church that could praise God. Amen. This morning we have heard out of the Old Testament Psalms 150, and forgive me, I want to set Paul giving honor to the bishop, the shepherd of this church, Bishop Johnson. Thank you for this opportunity, to my co-laborers in the ministry, Minister Carter, and to all of you, to the little boys as well as the little girls, it's good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. I remember an old gospel song he used to sing, glad to be in the service. He did not have to let me live. And that's the honest of God truth. We heard this morning Psalms 150. It talked about praising the Lord. I realize that oftentimes we depict our praise according to our denomination. And praise has no denomination. Praise is mere confidence in the one who you say you believe in. And sometimes we come to church and we get a little dignified to praise God. And sometimes it takes God for causing or raising havoc in our lives so we can get out of our dignified self and praise him. I often tell my church, don't wait until the battle's over. But in the middle of what you're going through, you have to praise God. Okay? A prime example, my mother, when we were younger, she shopped for our school clothes at Kmart. And because she couldn't afford just to pay the clothes right then and there, my mother would put our school clothes in what's called lelway. And so she puts it in lelway and she pays on our clothes. Now clothes may have been there so long we forgot we picked this outfit out. But what I'm saying is, in the midst of what you're going through, your praise is like paying on lelway. Because I've already put a down payment on it. So why would you praise God in the midst of your sickness? Because I know he's a healer. Why would you praise God in the midst of your loneliness? Because I know he's a company keeper. Because you don't have your deliverance yet. Yes, I know that. But I know it's there. But it just has not been manifested in the natural. So while I know it's there, I'm going to act like I put a down payment on it already. So I learned this, that when you praise God in the midst of all the hell that you're going through, the demons begin to shake and heaven begins to rejoice. And before you know it, I know a song that said, and he did it suddenly. I dare somebody in here is asking for God to do something miraculous in your life. But I dare you to have enough audacity in the midst of what you're going through. They say this, you're going to a Methodist church, they don't know how to praise. That's a lie. I've seen you praise God in this place. So in the preaching what I heard, I'm preaching what I know. Praise. It has been said that the main aim and goal is to praise God and enjoy Him forever. God, in His great wisdom and His creative power, has created us in His own image that we would return unto Him a sacrificial offering by praising Him as our Creator. Praise is what we are mandated to do, because God has given us the privilege, the pleasure, and the power to praise such a good God. We praise God not to entertain God. We praise God for who He is and for what He has done in our lives. We have a high level of expectancy that God will continue to bless us, and we will continue to praise His name on earth as it is in heaven. And when we see Him face to face, our hosannas will become hallelujahs. We will sit at His feet and be blessed. We will declare that Jesus is Lord, that Jesus is King of Kings, that He is Alpha and Omega. But until that day, while we have breath in our body, we are charged to praise God during the good times and praise Him during the bad. Understand that praise is not entertainment. The church has become a market-driven institution where at times you wonder if you're in the club or are you at church. It makes you wonder if you're listening to the beat or are you listening to the lyrics. And if you are listening to the lyrics, are the lyrics biblically and theologically sound? People in these days go from church to church looking for a quick fix. When things are not going right, they go to the next church looking who has the best choir and who has the best preacher. We have brought this secular, market-driven perspective into the house of worship. But in our passage of scripture, it keeps us focused on what praise is all about. The children of Israel, those who made up the house of God, they gathered in the temple and often would open up this book. The book of Psalms is a combination of prayer songs and sacred songs. Just like in most of our churches, we have what's called the hymn, the United Methodist hymn, the Baptist hymn, the African Methodist hymn. And this book of Psalms was considered the hymn book of the day. It had sacred songs, it had prayers, it had anthems, and they would use this as a symbol to praise God. In the book of Psalms, in 150, you find three questions. It's, where do we praise God? Why do we praise God? And what do we praise God with? Where do we praise God? It's found in verse 1. It says, praise ye the Lord, praise God in His sanctuary, praise Him in the firmament of His power. So that's the answer to this first question. Where do we praise God? We praise Him in where? The sanctuary. I don't know if you've ever gone through anything in life. I used to say, if I could just get to church on Sunday morning. Because if nobody else understands my praise, the people will understand my praise. What I like about the sanctuary is some of everything in the sanctuary. It's folks full of hurt that's in the sanctuary. Folks that are broken are in the sanctuary. Folks that have been rejected are in the sanctuary. Folks that have been oppressed are in the sanctuary. Folks that are depressed are in the sanctuary. Needing help, they are in the sanctuary. Employed, they are in the sanctuary. Underemployed, they are in the sanctuary. Unemployed, they are in the sanctuary. Sick, they are in the sanctuary. Heaven laden, they are in the sanctuary. Bipolar, they are in the sanctuary. Gay, they are in the sanctuary. Straight, they are in the sanctuary. Lesbian, they are in the sanctuary. Liars are in the sanctuary. Pimps are in the sanctuary. Prostitutes are in the sanctuary. Low self-esteem are in the sanctuary. Some of everything is in the sanctuary. sanctuary. Yeah. There's healing in the sanctuary. Yeah. Restoration in the sanctuary. Yeah. Revival in the sanctuary. Yeah. God in the sanctuary. And since some church is supposed to be peace, but I can't bring you peace in the sanctuary. But if I can just get to the sanctuary. Now they said there's deliverance in the sanctuary. Everything you need is in the sanctuary. And the church ought to look like some of everything in the sanctuary. In fact, the truth is, the church ought to look like the world, but not act like the world. And our praise is our weapon in the midst of our breakthrough. God doesn't dwell in the midst of pity. He dwells in the midst of praise. But understand this, that the devil has nothing against you. He has something against God. I don't understand that. The devil has nothing against you personally, but he has something against God. So when the enemy is attacking you, you can't take it personally. Because what the enemy is doing, he's telling on himself. Because the enemy knows that if you can discover your true purpose in God, this God's mind. Can I say this without being out of order? The reason why we so focused on chaos and mess up in the church, because the enemy does that to distract you. When we should be worshiping and when we should be focused on people's salvation, we focus on petty things. Why? Because the devil knows if Jones Memorial Discovery is true purpose, Theodore would be a dangerous place for the devil. And so he has nothing against you. He has it against God. And so he attacks you because you become so occupied by your issues. You become so occupied by problems. You become so occupied by situations that you forget what your true purpose is. The Bible says you are a woman of Zion. You are a powerful woman. In the midst of all that you're going through, I dare you to get down on your knees. Tell the devil you are defeated. You can't have this church. And then, men, I dare you to come together. Come together like royal ambassadors in God. Come together not for a social cup, but come together for like an army praying and chasing the devil out of this place and declare and decree the enemy is defeated. But while you are praying, I dare you to start praising, because praise will cause your blessing to come down and overtake you. Somebody clap your hands for me. Why do we praise God? We praise him for his mighty acts. We praise him according to his excellent greatness. The nation of Israel, they witnessed firsthand the power of God. They were in Egypt and God set them free. They crossed the Red Sea. God did it for them. They went out on dry land. God fed them manna from heaven. When they needed a leader, he gave them Moses, Joshua, Judges, and Queens. Whenever they needed, God blessed them. We praise him for his mighty acts. What is a mighty act of God? He woke you up this morning. Not only he woke you up this morning, he's giving you the activities of your limbs.